We've been in the house a little over 2 years. This is the biggest crowd we've ever had. Other than that Christmas holiday cookie exchange. That gets pretty crowded too, but it is such an honor for us to be able to open up your home for this event tonight. This is the people's house, and Lieutenant Governor Mallott and I, the First Ladies, Donna and Tony, we always like to have a gathering, but we've never had one like this. And we've never had one for a better reason than this. This is very, very special. I met Ken tonight for the first time, and here he comes now. This foundation, I'm so impressed with those that have vision. And this foundation was started by people that had vision. Ken, Reed Stoops, I know there's a third who I'm going to miss, but I know that it's a vision of something better for your community. And that's the message that makes Alaska what it is, because of people coming together saying, we want to make our community better. And my celebration, my thanks to Ken for all you have done and are doing and will do. Julie, thank you very much for making this evening what it is. So God bless you and God bless Alaska.
Yes, it really is just a blessing to us to be able to honor Ken tonight and to welcome all of you, his dearest friends. And as you know, Ken, as a longtime member of the Juneau Symphony, it's just such a delight tonight to have his friends from the symphony and dear friends providing the entertainment tonight. And I just especially want to thank Greg Berger and Mary and Full Circle Music, also dear friends of Ken, for the background music. And for the flutist, Sally Schlichting, I'm so sorry, and Lisa Ray, and pianist John Hayes. And following the program, we'll also hear from Kyle Farley Robinson on the piano. So thank you very much for being here. I also want to acknowledge the staff here at the Governor's House who made all of the food and the drink possible. Going to ask them to come forward because I know they're very busy, but if you see Lisa, Justin, Maxine, and Marisol, give them a big thank you. They really are doing so much more with so much less here at the house, and we're grateful for them, and we're grateful for all of you. Thank you so much.
Ken, it's a real honor for me on behalf of the Alaska State Legislature. I mean, I know you or known you when you first got here and were complaining to me. back in my other radio days, and it really is a distinct honor to present you this citation. And I'm not going to read the whole thing because everybody's going to talk about all the stuff that's in the citation. But on behalf of the Alaska State Legislature, signed by President of the Senate Pete Kelly, Speaker of the House Bryce Edgeman, and myself as sponsor, present this citation in honor of you for your many years of service.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you,
Senator and Mayor and friends.
You know, I've been around a long time, and there was a time when I saw this young guy everywhere I went. In Yakutat or wherever there was a gathering, he was in a kayak or he was in something. And he was kind of quiet, had this kind of very shy smile. At first I just wrote him off, you know, just another one of those coming up to take our country over. And after a while, he kept appearing. And so I began to ask people, who is this guy? And they said, that's Ken Leghorn. And he was associated with tourism. You know, I don't know what they called it back then, adventure travel and so forth. And then I was getting invited to fundraisers and other events and community events, and he'd always be there. very quiet, kind of in the background, but always present. And we eventually met. I am Ken Leghorn. I am Byron Mallott. And then I forgot his name. Who can forget the name Ken Leghorn? But in any event, it didn't work in reverse, because every time I saw him after that, he would come up to me, and even had been yesterday, he'd say, "Hi, I'm Ken Leghorn." <You know? laughs> and of course, it became clear that this was a special guy, a really special guy, that he was, in a very, very quiet way, essentially giving everything he had in life to Alaska while he absorbed Alaska. And the friends he made and the people that he hung out with were the kinds of people that I liked, at least some, Sam. And it became clear that, gosh, if there was a major public policy issue that involved our beautiful land, the people that inhabited it, Ken was there. That he was in the conversation, quietly helping to make it happen. He was someone who there are those who are the glue that make a good life happen. And Ken is one of those persons. Someone who someone who is in a place that is special, and the home and the life of those who inhabit it, who revere the place and want to keep it both special, but also know that it has to be shared, and who are always there, as I've said, and we said, to just kind of make it better without fanfare, without a lot of being out front or up front, who are just in the end, and you begin to see it and realize it, are so very special. And Ken Leghorn is one of those people, period. We've been working together on various issues and venues for many years now. And the last time I saw him, he came up to me and said, "Hi, I'm Ken Leghorn." And he's the kind of person that I think good and decent people who love this place can look at and sense, even if you've just met him and known him for just a short time, or if you've had a very long acquaintance, Ken, and you can say it without blushing, we love you. This is all I'm going to say, and it's pretty short for me. But I want to introduce someone whom I've also known for a long time. We used to fish together alongside one another when we were hand trolling way back when. Someone who was involved in philanthropic life, and I knew it right away, which I didn't know of Ken, But I knew it of Sam right away because of his name, Skaggs. Now, where did I hear that name before? Didn't there used to be a big company named Skaggs? But in any event, he also never carried that on his sleeve. He never was anyone but, like Ken, someone who wanted to come to Alaska and make it a better place, to make it a good home for him and his family, his children, to be able to, at the end of the day, walk away without looking back, not in a prideful sort of way, but with a deep sense of satisfaction, I think. I kind of helped to make a difference. And that's all that any of us can say. And I'd like to introduce you to you my very good friend, Sam Skaggs.
Thank you, man. Byron, thank you for that. You left me a few morsels to say about Ken. And Governor and First Lady Walker, thank you for opening up the Alaska home, as you say, to all of us. And wow, look around. I mean, this is a gathering that brings together, I think, all the facets of Ken's life and the many faces that he's worked with all these years. And what a great opportunity to reconnect. I'm seeing board members I haven't seen since the 80s. And if you don't know people, you get a chance to meet somebody new. I hope tonight you'll know a little bit more about Ken. So give me an opportunity just to give you a little background about this guy. Ken Leghorn is an entrepreneur, a conservationist, philanthropist, expert musician, alpine and Nordic skier.
Yeah.
He's been he's a father, he's a husband, he's a reliable neighbor. And as Byron said, he's a visionary. He's one of the most visionary people we have in Alaska right now. I like to call it, he has this work of an unbridled and creative mind, and he's two Energizer buddies in the same person. So it should come as no surprise that if I share how Ken came to Alaska from the East Coast, and he came like a lot of us. He's a tourist. But Ken wasn't your ordinary tourist. He came to Denali not to look at it, but to climb it with four college friends in 1978. And he did. After that, he said, okay, I'm going to go something tougher. So he came down with Steve Murley and made an attempt on Mount Fairweather. And shortly after that, with Scott and Betsy Fisher and Fred Hiltner, they went after the second tallest mountain in North America, Mount St. Elias. If you're a mountaineer and you know, just camping on these mountains, I'll hold the mic better here, just camping on these mountains on the coast. Wow, okay, I get it. Now I know what it sounds like if you're a rock and roll person, so. But anyway, just being on those mountains is an adventure in itself. So Ken's love affair with Southeast Alaska had begun. And what we now realize as Ken's style, fast and light, he quickly went to work to show his passion for the place that's his home. So let me just back up a little more. Long before Follow Your Bliss was a bumper sticker, Ken started out to make money and create a career out of what he loved doing. As an owner and operator, Ken grew the Gustavus-based Alaska Discovery into one of the West's premier outfitters. And he did this by constantly creating new adventures to go on and new places to explore. From Angoon to Yakutat, and from the Brooks Range to the Russian Far East. And yet, Ken wasn't just willing to take from his business. He started to work to implement policy to make change that Byron alluded to. And he worked to work protect areas in the Tongass. In 1986, with Angoon resident Matt Kukesh, Ken published the research on subsistence resources in Tenneke Inlet, and that led to the protection of Catoshan Trap Bay. Ken also worked tirelessly to help Berners Bay and Point Adolphus be protected, and he used the economic argument of ecotourism. Another example of Ken's vision was how he pioneered a rafting business with the Gold Belt Native Corporation, Oktisha, and he collaborated with the Nana Corporation to do trips out of the Kobuk River area in central Alaska. And most recently, Ken started a new business, Pack Creek Tours, with Kutznuwu, did I get that right, Byron? And Alaska Seaplanes. And this unique venture gives the corporation a business stake in the stewardship of Admiralty Island in the Kutznuwu wilderness. And it reminds conservation advocates of the cultural and traditional use of this world-class area. So not content to just be a mountaineer, Ken is also an experienced kayaker. He told John Sisk recently that he's paddled over 10,000 miles in southeast Alaska and rest of the coast of Alaska, it's southeast Alaska, Prince William Sound, and other parts of Alaska and Russia. Now 10,000 miles. I had to look that up. Anybody want to guess? Okay, Los Angeles to Cape Town, South Africa. Wow. This guy's been on his butt for a long time.
No ocean crossing.
So I like to think of Ken as the guide's guide. He's the friend you leave your float plan with because you know he'll send help or he'll come get you out of trouble. And if you're blind and you're about to go down a really steep hill and there's a right-hand turn at the bottom, this is the guy you want at your side giving the countdown. Okay, 1, 2, 3, turn. Because you see, you're blind. And if you're the president of the United States, and not this president, this is the guide you want to take your daughter out in the wilderness on her first kayak trip. I like this word guide to depict Ken, and here's three definitions I found. See if they fit. Number one, guide. To assist a person to travel through or reach a destination in an unfamiliar area as by accompanying or giving directions. How about adding in campsite cooking in all kinds of inclement weather, first aid, extreme logistics, and people management skills? Okay, we got guide one. Guide two, to force a person, object, or small animal or animal to move in a certain path. So now I think you answer the next question. Now, how many of you have ever experienced or been nudged by Ken's border collie tendencies? Number three, guide. To supply a person with advice or counsel as in practical or spiritual affairs. Now here's where Ken excels. Ken sees you as a person and is appreciative of who you are and remembers what you have done. And more, he articulates this with sincerity and humor. In philanthropy, he seeks out a donor's passion and guides that towards valuable and worthy community causes. Ken's guidance to community and statewide art and environmental organizations is why we are honoring him tonight. I just want to give you a few examples. So while Ken was blazing away on his job creating new wilderness expeditions for clients, he was just as busy creating and leading Alaska's environmental organizations. For 17 years, he served on the board of the Alaska Conservation Foundation. We fondly refer to this as ACF, the Green Foundation. And he started his term when Denny Welcher, the first executive director, was still running ACF. And upon arriving at ACF, he coaxed the board and to put in the mechanisms in place to grow a fund to support conservation efforts in the state that grew under $3 million under his watch. And as chair, as I'm really glad to see several folks here from the early days of ACF, he helped steer ACF through some really difficult times. And he did that with his diplomatic skills. And while there was lots of program expertise on the ACF board, no one was really fundraising. So Ken decided that would be his niche, to bring the resources to make all the work happen. And boy, did he go to task. In addition to creating that first capital fund, when David Rockefeller created Sail Alaska to introduce over 250 friends to Alaska on sailing trips over 2 summers, Ken saw an opportunity. He turned those participants into donors with a new fund called the Alaska Fund for the Future. And that fund grew so large to endow internships at many conservation organizations throughout the state. When ACF founder Celia Hunter, dear friend of mine from Fairbanks days and dear friend of many people in this room, and when she died, within 24 hours, Ken had already created the Celia Hunter Endowment. And when tragedy struck Ted Smith, an amazing person who was the program officer from the Kendall Foundation and also an ACF board member, Ken created yet another endowment in his name. Now, most people don't know how to do this. To honor by giving and keeping the work of others alive. But Ken makes it easy. Ken learned a lot about himself during these fundraising efforts. He actually loved it. So he decided to get better at it, moving off the Alaska Nature Conservancy's board, and he became the development assistant for Southeast. He said he wanted to learn from the best, and by going to many development trainings, he raised $400,000 in his first year for the Shore Zone and Estuary Classification Project. So beyond ACF and TNC, Ken's skills have supported many other organizations. Audubon Alaska, and after having Discovery Southeast with Scott Berlinski and myself, he went on to support the executive directors, Cinda Stanek, Beth Weigel, and currently Sean Isley with major fundraising campaigns. So not only is Ken a creator and a catalyst, he ante's up every year to help those organizations that he's passionate about. I also have to mention just a few more things. For 7 years, he was a volunteer guide, has been a volunteer guide, including this year, with the Ski for Light Foundation. And I don't know if people saw it in the Juneau Empire last week, there was a great article about this wonderful program that Ken has helped to shape and bring Juneau skiers into the fold to help blind people ski and race. And as Byron said, or somebody said, don't forget he's played violin in the Juneau Symphony for 37 years.
Right behind that mark.
And he became a force with Linda Rosenthal to raise funds for Juneau Jazz and Classics, to bring the amazing talent that comes to Juneau every year. I mean, who can forget now Grammy-winning award cellist Zuel Bailey when he came to Juneau? I mean, I remember that. I'm sure you do too. And finally, I know you've been waiting for that word, but it's really hard to condense all this. Finally, tonight, we're particularly honoring Ken's service with 10 years with the Juneau Community Foundation. And Ken was instrumental in the original incorporation team, along with Reed Stoops and Eric Kueffner to my left, and became the first executive director of the Juneau Community Foundation. And what he did was put in place all the nuts and bolts that make a community foundation successful. And it's a tremendous task. He also helped create the first 30 donor-advised and memorial funds, and along with the donated investment advice from Peter Giraz, Ken Horst oversaw the creation of the first 2 investment funds for the new endowment. Now, Ken is working to raise $25 million for the Juneau Performing Arts Center. In this effort, he's bringing his creative experience of his entire career to secure a beautiful and functional cultural center for our capital city. Ken, Thank you for being our philanthropic guide and making so many important programs and projects happen. We're the beneficiaries of all that you've given on all many levels. Thanks for being the conservation champion you are. The state's environment and wilderness is immeasurably better because of that. Thanks for being my friend for 30 years. And on behalf of everyone here tonight, I echo Byron, we love you and we thank you for being Alaska's friend.
It's all yours.
Well done. Thank you, sir.
Hello. My name is Ken Leghorn. Yeah, I'm just never sure who's going to forget that. And that was amazing, Sam. Thank you so very much. Sam made a major omission, however. I'm not going to bring him back up here to correct it, but for many of those ventures that he cited, he was either at my side or, more typically, out in front. How's this mic level for the people in the back room? Good, all right. Well, I also want to thank two very special young women for flying up from Portland today through the snow, being here tonight. They share an apartment in Portland. They both go to Portland State. They grew up on opposite sides of the same street on Chicken Ridge. And their names are Leia Skaggs and Yana Leghorn Warner. I also want to thank Yana's mom, Sue, for being here tonight. Thank you. So this is an incredibly meaningful event for me at this stage of life. I want to thank you so much. And I'm going to talk just a few minutes about what philanthropy has meant to me. To me, it's about, yes, time, yes, energy, yes, expertise, but actually it's about giving money away. It's about gifting, right? It's taking your hard-earned dollars that you are earning now or have saved and giving it to causes that you believe in. It's investments in ideas, but it's really investments in people, the people that are going to bring those ideas to fruition. The results are a better life, better community, I would say a better earth, but I don't think we can improve on the one we've got. And along the way, there's just incredible meaning and amazing friendships that develop. And it leads to a result like this gathering of people that share the same values. They say childhood and college creates lifelong friends. Yeah, I've got about 10 of those still. But look here tonight, working with you people for 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, that creates incredible deep friendships from doing work together. So I'd like to acknowledge some of the people that are here tonight, especially those that traveled in just by organization. We've heard about the Alaska Conservation Foundation. That was a big part of my life for 17 years. And a lot of the old trustees have flown in. Can you raise your hand if you're a past trustee of ACF? And I say old, not just in terms of long serving, but actually very old. like me. Fortunately, they had the wisdom to hire a very dynamic young executive director born and raised in Anchorage. And he is here tonight too, Michael.
Barber.
Where are you? Michael Barber in the back. Elsa Lynn from Anchorage with Audubon Alaska. We have Executive Director Nils Warnock and his Development Director Michelle Laveau. Thank you, Nils and Michelle. And I'll do a longer list so you can stop clapping because we're getting to Juneau. So starting with my business for over 25 years that often felt like a nonprofit. All of you connected with Alaska Discovery in some way, can you just show who you are? And more recently, another business slightly more profitable, those here from Alaska Seaplanes. Great, thank you guys for coming. And Erica. And then, we've mentioned Juneau Symphony. We've got the past and the current board president here. Thank you both for being here. We've got the only other violinist that has played longer in the symphony than me, and that's Kathy Moss. And her equally long trumpet-playing husband, Ron Moss. Got a few folks here from SEAC. Another great organization. Raise your hand if you're... Yep, folks here from SEAC, thank you. And let's see, Discovery Southeast. Several past executive directors and staff naturalists that are here. Please raise your hand. So, Carson Singh and Murley, yep, along with Cinda and Beth Weigel. Great. And then my current favorite organization, the new Juneau Arts and Culture Center. We are following Peter Giraz's leadership one more time with a $25 million campaign, so talk to Peter. And then I also want to thank our current sponsor for tonight, Juneau Community Foundation, and especially to Amy and Jenna for organizing all of this. So if philanthropy is about giving away money, let's talk about how much we're talking about. And let's leave annual memberships aside and talk about what does it take to be a significant donor to an organization. Well, when I got off the ferry almost 40 years ago, and just before I ran into Mr. Mallott here, you remember me? For $500 or $1,000, you could be a major donor to any organization in town and be one of their most significant supporters. Well, guess what? That number hasn't moved by a dollar in 40 years. It's still the same $1,000. And it's not because people in this town aren't generous and incredibly giving. They're supporting about 300 nonprofits. It's mostly because they're not being asked. That bar just hasn't been raised to match, you know, inflation, but especially the incredible work that's being done. So I want to talk about what happens when you give an organization $5,000 or $10,000 or more. You start to be part of transformative ideas and investing more in the people that you realize are doing the good work. So then imagine, what if you took your $5,000 and went to your favorite charity and said, I'm going to give you $5,000 a year for 5 years, and I'll help you find 9 other people to do the same. What would you do with $250,000 commitment? Wow. New program, new staff position, new ideas, something transformative, new technology, membership campaigns. You know, amazing things can start to happen that you are part of and that you helped make happen. Well, there's an organization here tonight that's doing exactly that kind of donor-driven fundraising and philanthropy right now, and that's the Juneau Community Foundation, who is on the cusp of launching several new funds that are variously called field of interest funds or focus funds, but basically community sources of support for a few, a few very broad but well-defined areas of grant-making in this community. And those funds will grow into incredible sources of community impact, mostly through bequests and very large gifts. But to get started, they need to prove themselves and show the kind of work that they can do, and that takes seed money. So, inspired by their own past board member gift from the Corbis family to see what kind of instant impact you get when you give large gifts, the board of Juneau Community Foundation is stepping up in leadership roles to help launch these funds. They've hired Jamie Waste. Where are you, Jamie? They've hired Jamie Waste to lead this whole effort along with Amy Skillbred. And if you're one of those board leaders, can you just raise your hand? So since I mentioned bequests, it never hurts to give a nudge or guide you to, yeah, create a will, update your will, and then, of course, add charitable gifts. Juneau Community Foundation is a great way to do that with a variety of funds to give to. Alaska Conservation Foundation is kind of a community foundation for the environment. And most of the well-established large charities in town have a way to receive bequests. So that's my nudge. In closing, I just want to step back from philanthropy and look at the human values that connect us all. And there's an embodiment of those values tonight in two people that we've already heard from. Their names are Bill and Byron. They have some other fancy title, but I'm talking about them as people, not as politicians. I'm talking about leadership with integrity and with honesty and the highest of ethical standards. I'm talking about working every day to make our society better. And I say this is leadership that we are showcasing to the nation, and isn't this a proud time to be an Alaskan? I'm just gonna close with a shout out to Mandy Mallott. Mandy. Mandy Mallott. Yeah, who along with Mrs. Walker know how to put on one heck of a party. Thank you all friends for coming tonight and for being part of this incredible community.
Don't go. Thanks, Jamie. My name is Reed Stoops. I'm on the board and one of the founders of the Community Foundation. I've lived here since the early 70s. I've known Ken since he first got to Juneau. What year was that? 1978. And hard to follow Donna and the governor and Byron and Sam, and I've learned a lot about Ken tonight, but even if he only did one thing, and that was to help Eric and I start the Juneau Community Foundation, that would have been enough all by itself. I mean, that was back in 2000 when the three of us got together and kicked around the ideas that led to the creation of the foundation. And you know, we started as a volunteer effort with no money and no support other than the three of us. And anyway, we started out with nothing. And after several years, we got our 501c3 thanks to Eric, started raising money. And pretty soon, we had enough money that we couldn't do it as a purely volunteer effort anymore. So we got Ken to serve as our first executive director. He had to leave the board in order to do that. And it was largely through his efforts that the Community Foundation grew from zero to $52 or $53 million at the present. We gave away $2.5 million this year to local nonprofits in pretty much every area of social services and education, arts, in the community. And we've been responsible for building the Diamond Park Field House. We were instrumental in the new Housing First homeless shelter that'll be ready in June, which was even a bigger project. The Quet Cabin, the Seward Statue, the Empty Chair Project, and I'm sure there'll be a number of other ones in the future. And I'll give a plug, since I'm one of the people working on the Field of Interest funds, mine and Mike McCrill, is Parks, Recreation, and Trails. So if you donate to one of the Field of Interest funds, I'll put in a plug for ours. we're gonna try to get the Treadwell Ditch Trail finished sooner rather than later. We wanna explore We also envisioned a series of mountain shelters on the mainland from Thunder Mountain all the way down to Taku Inlet and on Douglas Island so that people can spend the nights when they're hiking or running the ridges. And we're going to work on local parks. I think the Auk Bay or Auk Lake area isn't. Anyway, all of this, if you go back, is in large part thanks to Ken's effort. He was a visionary on this like every one of his other projects, and I couldn't be prouder to be a friend and acquaintance with Ken, and can't thank him enough for his service to Juneau.
I knew Ken Leghorn by reputation long before I met him. I knew him as the guy who was always going on the coolest trips to the most exotic locations. I probably first ran into him at Eagle Crest, but I have since encountered him everywhere, as a wilderness guide, as a business client of my law firm, as a violinist, and as an earnest supporter of conservation causes. Whenever you see Ken, you welcome the encounter because he's so giving of himself. He also makes you feel that you really should be giving more yourself, more time, more money, more effort. He's one of those rare people who is able to come right out and make the ask, as we say in the charitable foundation biz. He's not embarrassed to name a specific sum and force you to think about whether you can really afford not to contribute to whatever worthy cause he's pitching. Thomas Hoving, who's the director, was the director of the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York, once said, "If you ask them for money and their knuckles don't turn white on the arms of their chair, then you didn't ask for enough." When knuckles go white in front of Ken, it's not because the target is scared to see him, but because they're scared to contemplate their own true nature. Who am I? What can I really give? Because it's only by measuring what we can give that we can truly know who we are. Ken makes you feel that, and he makes you feel better about yourself for feeling that way. So I was never afraid when Ken hit me up for a significant contribution of time, effort, or indeed money. I welcomed it, even though my knuckles turn white sometimes, because Ken is someone you want to see. This aspect of his nature is best illustrated by a famous story involving Ken Leghorn, Sharon Gateman, and Harrison Ford. Ken was in Juneau one time with Harrison Ford. I don't know why, presumably because he was a celebrity client and he was taking him around Alaska. In any event, they were having lunch at a restaurant in Juneau, and Sharon Gateman saw them there. Sharon is not a shy or quiet person, and she's not about to let the opportunity of a movie star get by her. So she came into the restaurant and said, "Oh my God, it's Ken Leghorn!" And that is what we can say here today. Oh my God, it's Ken Leghorn. Ken, without further slowing us down, I'd like to present this Founders Award to you from the Community Foundation in recognition of all your philanthropic efforts and all the things that you've done that have been described here today. Thank you so much. We want to thank the governor, Mrs. Walker, for hosting this, and everybody, you can hang around here till 7:30 and when they're going to kick us out. But thank you so much for all of this, and thank you, Ken. Thank you.